Hey everyone, this is Austin Schur here with We Write About Music, and today I'm here with Vanalika. She has just put out a summer anthem that goes by the title of Lonely, and it is amazing. Super excited to talk to her about it. Van, thank you so much for being here today. How are you doing?
I am doing fantastic. You know, the weather's starting to warm up, so it's getting me in that summery mood for sure.
Sweet. What part of the world are you located in?
I am from Dallas, Texas.
Ooh, very cool. Yeah.
It gets
enjoy that. I was going to say, yeah, enjoy that time between the super cold and the super hot where you're just
we get
pulling
one
layers
maybe.
Off. Yeah. I've spent a little bit of time in Texas and yeah, you have to wear like a few outfits per day because you're just sweating so much.
My idea is to just stay home and stay in the air conditioning instead so I don't have to really deal with all that.
Yeah, probably for the right reasons.
Exactly.
Enough about the weather though, we could talk about that anytime. I want to talk about your single, which is awesome. First thing I want to know about is that it is titled Lonely. So obviously I want to hear about the lyrical content and sort of like the background of what inspired you to make it.
Yeah, and I would love to talk about it. Please. So one of my biggest things with this song, I actually read an article about a year or so ago, and it was a woman who was assaulted, but she didn't get any justice for the crimes committed against her. And one of the biggest things that resonated in that article that I read was the person who assaulted her, the man was excused because he was deemed too lonely to have made a sane decision. It was a very weird wording, and it was very interesting for me to read that, and almost like a light bulb moment in a bad way, where I realized this is more common and this was excused way more often than people realized. And that's where the song title comes from. And it was really almost like an ironical pointing out of how ridiculous that word sounds in that context. And I started writing the song and the idea of it being very aggressive, me screaming at the world and really just showing my anger and frustration, you know, not only being a woman, but just being a human. And then I kind of switched my perspective a little, and that's what you really hear coming out of my song now. It's the reason I decided to dive towards more of that summery, fun feeling was because I wanted to declare this term as a confident rejection. And what I mean by that is there is no reason for lonely to be deemed as an excuse that I can confidently say there's no justification for that. I don't need to yell at anyone. I don't need to scream it at the top of my lungs. It's common sense to most people out there. And that's really the idea I wanted to go with the song. It's that it's a confident declaration more than anything. It's not aggression. It's not screaming. It's just me owning myself and me declaring, this is how it's going to be. You don't get to do what you want to do. You don't get to see what you want to see. You don't get to be lonely. As simple as that.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. And that's really the whole perspective.
No, that's great. That's exactly the type of explanation I was hoping for. And honestly, I had no idea about that. And I mean, not to jump too deep, but like guys like that just are the worst. Like, I don't know.
You don't say.
It's just why. I mean, I don't know. I could talk about it for days. And
no, I
am. But like, yeah, I
was thinking about it for days writing the song. It was
right.
It was a very emotionally driven song, but I had to kind of take a different perspective on it and see what I wanted to actually come out of the song. And one of the big things with this song is, and one of the big things with music is, artists can use their platform to spread awareness about important topics. But I didn't want to put it in a way that people wouldn't listen to it. People wouldn't want to acknowledge the deeper and darker tones of the lyrics simply because the music reflects that. So I wanted to almost create like a little bit of paradox where the music sounds so fun, summery, joyful, jumping out there. But the lyrics kind of show something a little different so that the audience gets a chance to digest it a bit more easily and it to be more palpable and palatable for them. And unfortunately, it has come to a point where we have to do things like that, but I honestly would rather have it that people hear the message than not at all. So
absolutely. Well, I love that you've done that because, I mean, you think about the people that listen to music in general, and I'd say like 90%+ of the people who take in music are just like, oh, that sounds good. And they don't actually dive deeper into what it sounds like. So it's like you're taking a super dense, important message and putting into this like happy go lucky summary song. And for those, no, but seriously, those that are going to dig deeper and actually focus in and listen are going to get a lot more out of it than those that are just dancing around to it.
So yeah.
I respect that.
Thank you. And that was really the intention behind it. It was that at least this gives me a chance to stop people in their tracks and they can actually have a chance to listen to the lyrics, because unfortunately lyrics aren't the first thing people listen to. And I mean, I myself, I'll usually judge a song based off of the first 15 seconds or the introduction and how catchy that is. And that's why you continue listening. And I really want to get that across with Lonely.
Totally. Well, you've done that. I'll say that much. It makes you want to listen past 15 seconds.
I will say I tried.
Yeah. I actually really want to talk about the production on the song as well, because it sounds great. There's so many cool elements going on, and it just... it's very like bright sounding in part. I don't know. It's got a lot of positives to it, obviously. I'd love to know, were you involved in the production? How did you sort of form it all?
Yeah. And so I took this project, right? And I went to my amazing, amazing producer, Jonathan Camacho. And I told him, hey, here's this really dark song I wrote. Let's not make it that dark.
Yeah.
And that was, it really started there. It started with this conversation of trying to figure out where we wanted to go. And funny story, this is actually like the fourth, fifth version of the song. We did so many different versions of it to get across that image and that style that we were going for. Okay. And, you know, one of the biggest inspirations for this song is Watermelon Sugar by Harry Styles. We really want to capture that summery feel, but also there is a hint of depth behind it. And that was taken from artists like Dua Lipa, who are very like funky, bass driven. So you really want to combine those elements. And obviously we break away from that character of summer during like the bridge when there are all those speeches happening to bring into reality that this is still a topic that we want to focus on and this is still not going to be distracted from. And yeah, from there, it was a roller coaster. We just kind of messed around with things. We both sat there for hours on end, me sitting there listening to him and then him listening to me, going back and forth, ranting to each other, not only about the intricacies of the topic, but also about what guitar did we want to use, what drums were suitable to get that feeling across, but still not derail from it. So,
that's awesome.
You know, I could go on hours and hours about the very specifics, but really the whole point of it was we wanted to build an atmosphere and that's what we did. We just drilled at getting the atmosphere down.
Awesome. So not necessarily on the single, but I suppose in like the grand scheme of everything that you've made so far, what are you trying to accomplish in terms of, I guess, the awareness? Like, does each specific song feature a message? Are they all heavy or are some more lighthearted?
I think heavy and lighthearted is actually quite subjective to people. Love can be the most heavy topic in the world. Love can be the most lighthearted topic in the world. Sure. And I think that's the biggest thing I wanted to get across. It's that it's up for interpretation. And I was having a conversation about this earlier, that even the term lonely can be taken in so many different interpretations, considering we're in a pandemic. There's so many different ideas even to that. And that's really when I wanted to give people space. And I wanted to have my music where I have my interpretation of it, but also there's enough space and a little bit of leverage for people to take their own from it. And that is what my goal for music is. It's not really to project my views or project my opinion on something, but rather to bring attention to a certain area or a certain topic and see what people get out of that and really just start a conversation more than anything.
I love that. I mean, there's nothing better than subjective music instead of like in your face, this is what this is about, no interpretation. And I know, and it really goes back to what you're saying about like having this breezy, light, summery track, and then you actually listen and it's not. See,
exactly. And so people could be thinking it's a dance track, and then reality they hear it, oh, I guess it's something different entirely.
Yes, exactly. So I don't want to hop too far into the future here, but I do have to know, you know, I loved this. Is there a follow-up coming? Are you constantly working on things?
I have quite a crazy brain. I'll say that. I'm consistent.
Brain of an artist.
I would say just brain of a person who can't stop thinking more than anything. Yeah. I think the difference between an artist and everybody else is we put pen to paper. We just happen to write down those thoughts and like craziness coming through our mind.
Yeah.
There's really no other difference. So I will say, especially with the pandemic and everything, and just, you know, life starting to get back out there, there's so many thoughts running through my mind that I obviously had to document it. So I've got a pretty cool few things in store, and a few things that are darker, of course, talking about important topics of the world, but things that also capture my personality, capture my atmosphere, capture the vibe I want to go for. And I'm really looking forward to that. And it, the future is looking pretty interesting. I'll say that.
Sweet. All right. So not so much in the context of the music, or not so much in the context of the lyrics, but the actual music itself. Are you looking to like experiment your sound, take any like huge strides for, you know, like, or, you know, or some people feel like they've found their lane and they don't want to stray from it. So I guess it depends.
You know, saying you found your lane is really funny to me, because even when we're driving, we can never stay in one lane, right? We always have to me personally, I can identify myself as an indie R&B artist, but I don't think that's restrictive. I think there's so many elements of indie and there's so many elements of R&B. There's alternative. There's like so many like soft R&B, soft indie. There's so many different perspectives to that. Yeah. And I'm willing to explore all of it. And I want to explore all of it, because I don't think that, especially in today's day and age, we're limited to one sound, or only one sound is marketable or sellable. It's whatever sound truly says, hey, I'm Vanalika, here's my music. So that's really what I'm going for here. I don't like to hone myself back, and I don't think any artist needs to really, because they just need to keep going until they find their perfect flavor of music.
Totally. I say that all the time, that the world of being a certain genre artist is such a thing of the past at this point, especially with how easy it is to produce or even learn how to like put new elements into songs. Exactly. There's no point in just saying I'm a pop artist, I'm a rock artist, I'm a country artist, because one, you may lose out on listeners who stereotype you into something. And then and then it doesn't leave anything open for experimentation or kind of branching out. So I love that. Keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
I do want to know though, so even just on the R&B side, or just music in general, like who are some of your musical inspirations? Who have you grown up listening to, or even as of recently sort of inspired sound that you're making?
Yeah, someone I'll say I grew up listening to, my household was a very big Jackson 5 and Michael Jackson fan. So, and that's someone that's really influenced not only my songwriting process, but my stage presence process. I mean, we got to say he's the king of pop for a reason. And what
always and forever.
Exactly. He's one of my biggest influences. I love the funky style he goes for in all of his music. And I think that balance between having the vocals so beautifully laid on top, but also having a very strong instrumentation underneath, is very important for me personally as a musician and as an artist in general. People I look up to in terms of like lyrical quality or in terms of just their songwriting process, I love Ed Sheeran, I love Khalid, and I love Lorde. And the thing common between all of them is their authenticity and the way they're not afraid to talk about topics that are typically difficult to talk about, or even things that are just personal that you wouldn't really expect an artist to put themselves out there. I mean, that's really important for artists to be able to be vulnerable with their listeners and with people who can connect with their music, because they're giving a voice to those, right? In terms of music and in terms of the vibe I really am trying to go for, I can't say there's one person that defines it all, but I have really started looking into Harry Styles, as I mentioned. He's a big influence. I've also gotten into Dua Lipa, and really the big perspectives in that is that funkiness and getting that retro edge. I think that's just the coolest sound that's come out of the modern trends of music. I think it's, you know, going retro, as cheesy as it sounds, is actually turning out to be a pretty cool movement amongst all of this like modern trends and things happening. So those are some of my top influences. I gotta say, I obviously look up to the classics like Beyonce and my queens, like all of our classic people to look up to. I look up to them as a woman and as a girl in music and artistry, just because they set a precedent, and I hope one day that I can use my platform just like them to show other people that it's not just a woman common thing, but people can get out there and people can do what they love and stay true to themselves. So
I love that. Sort of a follow-up question to that is, so I've heard about all these artists that you love, and I agree, they're all amazing. I think we listen to probably the same music, is my guess. But was there a specific album in your life that sort of put you over the edge to take that path as a musician? Something that you listened to that you were like, I want to try to emulate that in my own style, or just make something of my own?
I think, and this was someone I actually hadn't mentioned in the previous list, but there's an artist, I'm pretty sure you're familiar, Frank Ocean. Yes. And his Channel Orange album, and specifically his song Lost in That. Mm-hmm. It's my number one favorite song. I love that song. Okay. But not just for the fact that it sounds amazing, but also for the fact that it's very experimental in the way the vocals are built out and the way that instrumentation comes together, but you can't say it's weird. And that's like one of my biggest things. I want to be experimental, but I don't necessarily think experimental needs to be associated with being weird in music.
There's plenty of that.
Yeah, and I think definitely if you're making funky music, please be my guest. Sure. We all need to expand our taste in that regard. But I just want to get that notion away that being experimental means you're creating weird music, because that's really not the case. All sort of pop music started off as experimental, and now look at where they are. So I would say that's one of my biggest ones, because it shows a true blend of what experimental / underground music and what pop elements combined together can create. So
totally, I think, yeah, just experimental in general is such a it's changed its form as a word, because like there are bands that are experimental that they're just like screaming into microphones and mm-hmm. playing like jungle noises, and yeah. Like yeah, that's super experimental, but that's like the far end of the spectrum. I don't know,
I think
it's lost its meaning almost.
Exactly. Like, what does experimental mean? Isn't that really just you're experimenting with your music?
Like trying new foods. Exactly. Like, oh, super experimental chickpea pasta. I tried
like, something. Okay, like, that's experimental. And then other people are like, I had fettuccine Alfredo today.
Whoa, very experimental. Super experimental. Stupid. So I want to hear a little bit more into your process as a musician. How specifically do you start a song? Does it always start the same way with a lyric or a bass line or something like that?
For me, the number one way I start any song is actually not even thinking about the song. I think about the vibe or atmosphere I want a song to create. Okay, okay. This was especially pertinent with not only Lonely, but with my previous single, No Feelings, that I released. The image I had in my mind was a red room, or like a red LED just lit room with a red couch in the center. It's just, I went with that image, and that's where the song kind of went from there. Cool. I built chords, I built my lyrics, everything around that. And the reason I always like driving my song around an atmosphere, I think the biggest thing with music, you can go on and on about thinking about your lyrics, about your chord structure, about everything, about the intricacies, but if that doesn't make your listeners actually be entranced by the vibe you're trying to put out there, then to me, you haven't really written a song that is captivating, that is actually trying to serve its purpose of being entertainment, of being something that people actively want to listen to. Right. So that's one of the reasons I kind of try and put myself in the position of a listener before I hop into actually any of my intricate songwriting processes, because at the end of the day, all of us are listeners. We all consume music. So we should be thinking from that perspective, because we're exactly that. So that's really where I start off with any song. It's thinking of that vibe. And with Lonely, what had initially started as that aggressive marching down a road vibe had transitioned into a red vintage car driving down a summer road. That was the aesthetic I was going for. Okay. And that's where it began. With the music itself, it's a little harder, obviously, to think in that direction, because you're doing it acoustically, you're just doing it intimately with yourself. And the place where you can really see that come alive is your production, is everything else after. But for me, it's very important to keep that vibe and atmosphere in mind, so that I know exactly what direction I want to go for my music and what direction I want to be taking, not only the music itself, but videography, looks, colors, all the intricacies of the brand.
Of course. I've never heard that as a process style before, and I love it, because no, it's always like, yeah, some guy sent me a demo and that was it. And then we just went, but like being like, I want to emulate this material object is just like such a cool way to take it. So that's
Thank you.
awesome.
Thank you.
So tell me this though, besides the freedom, what is it that you enjoy the most about being an artist and a creative as a whole?
For me, the biggest thing about music, I've actually moved around my entire life. I moved, funny story, in 1 year I was in three different cities.
Oh,
And
jeez.
I moved house to house in three different cities across the globe. Like one was in India, one was in Australia, and one was here in the United States. So I am not new to moving around and being the new kid on the street or being someone who's new in an environment that I'm just not familiar with. And throughout all of that, I can say music has been my bridge. Music has been the one thing that's constant for me throughout my entire life because I started off as a singer when I went to preschool, and ever since then I've been doing music. I learned piano and then I got into songwriting. And what I mean by that is music is that backbone for me. It's not just a material thing that I do whenever I have free time. It's really just another part of me. Like, you can't say I'm Vanalika without my music or without my artistry. And I think that's the biggest thing for me, is it's a representation of my authenticity and my personality. So that's like really more than all of the aspects of music, as in, oh, I get to put my music out there, I get to hear have people listen to my music, which are all so amazing things. But for me, it's the fact that really there's nothing to me if my music was not a part of who I am.
Love that. Is there a possibility of you going on the road or at least doing some local shows sometime this year, maybe early
Sure.
next?
No, definitely. I mean, I think going on the road is one of the coolest things because you get to see people reacting to your music live. That's the coolest and scariest thing for me. But definitely, it's in the plans for the future. One of the biggest things I'm really focusing on is getting my music to a point where it's solid. And what I mean by that is essentially building my base, right? Building people who I know want to listen to my music and I know want to take their own interpretation for my music. So that's really what we're focusing on, and what I'm focusing on is to create that really cool group of people who I know will be cheering me on in the background anytime I perform at a show. And of course, within the next year or so, we're looking at very, very, very very likely possibilities for there to be a tour and for there to be a lot of cool shows put together.
Nice. Well, I am in Los Angeles, so if you just want to schedule
Oh my
something over
God.
here, that
Yes,
would be great,
I
please.
love me some LA, I will say.
Right, so hypothetically then, let's say the tour is planned, but the venue owners are like, "Oh, you only got one song. What's that one song gonna be?" It could also be something that maybe you haven't put out, but you're like, "Ooh, yeah, that song's gonna bang when I actually play it live."
You know, more than that song's gonna bang when I play it live, it's that song started in the weirdest way possible. And that is my next song I'm planning on releasing after Lonely. And I think the reason I would say that actually is I would create it, the song is very different from anything I've put out before. And it's very, very specific on that atmosphere that I wanted to create. And I think whenever you're performing live, the biggest thing to do is to get people in that atmosphere because, hey, you're right there. May as well do it,
Yeah.
right?
Well, yeah, you're creating your world and you
Exactly.
want
And
to pull people into it.
yeah, and that's a song I can definitely see the world being very interactive and very just in your face. So that would be my favorites. I know that's leaving you in a bit of a suspense, but I swear
You have to
it's
build
worth
suspense. You
the
don't need to tell me. You don't need to tell anyone. You can just say it's coming and you should watch out for it.
Oh yeah.
Gotta
I mean,
build the
I
hype.
couldn't have said it better myself, so
So you have also listed a ton of great artists throughout this entire interview so far. So now I have to know who, if you had to pick one, doesn't even have to be one of them, a dream collaboration would be, whether they're going to produce the song, feature on the song, any part of it.
For me, a dream collaboration with a producer who I hadn't mentioned is actually Billie Eilish's producer and brother, Phineas.
Yeah, he's and great.
For me, I think the biggest thing that even my producer, Jonathan, and I have talked about is the way he works, like the way his mind mm-hmm. works and seeing that creativity. Like his music and Billie's music are experimental. They're just doing what they want to do and they're putting their music out there. And right. like, for example, there was this interview where he said for Bad Guy, they recorded a pedestrian stop sign sound. And that was like the snare of the entire like Bad Guy, like the big song of Billie Eilish.
Got some time on your hands if you can just record
I
that,
thought that was the
right
cool.
I mean it is cool.
I thought that was so like they were walking down the sidewalk and they thought that was a sound I want to use for a future big smashing hit. And I'm hoping that I get a pedestrian sidewalk sound of my own working with Phineas. So
I think you just have to walk around town and maybe
exactly.
like someone will shout something and you'll just have it. You should just walk around downtown Dallas with your phone recorder on for like an hour and then listen back to it.
And if anything, I'll literally create some pretty dramatic scenes. Like I'll go screaming around, I maybe drop like a hammer on the floor or something. Yes. Like I'll do it. I'm fine with that. But definitely he's one of the people I want to work with just to see how the creativity can flow and see what magic can come out of it.
I love that. What's the name of the documentary? I'd love to watch it actually.
Oh my gosh. It was in their most recent one. Why? I think it's the world's a little blurry or like
Okay.
It's the one on Apple TV, but this interview was also, if you just search it up.
I'm sure I can find it.
Yeah, it was like when I saw it just scrolling through my feed, but awesome. I thought it was like the strangest story ever to say like the fundamental part of the song was like built upon a pedestrian sidewalk sound that they just happened to find on a vacation in Australia. Like, okay.
It has to start somewhere, I suppose. Right. Might as well start there. Oh man. So I've only got a couple more questions for you at this point, but I gotta know, we are nearly halfway through this year, which is wild. But non-musically, how are you, you know, are you setting goals for yourself as a person, aside from the music making?
Mm-hmm. And you know, with this being the longest half year of, I think, any of our lives, and even the longest year of any of our lives,
sure.
something I always say coming out of, or really entering and kind of transitioning out of the pandemic was that I'm not the person I was before. I couldn't even recognize myself. And I think one of the biggest things for me these past few months have been discovering, as cheesy as it sounds, discovering myself. But really what I mean by that is starting to focus on things I truly enjoy and focusing on building relationships with people I truly enjoy being around. And even if that made me a little bit of a recluse, I think I can say I'm a bit more satisfied with that than talking to people and doing things that don't necessarily bring me satisfaction. So as philosophical and cheesy as that may sound, that's truly what I've been doing. I've been chilling and enjoying spending time with myself, which is something I had to personally had to learn, being someone who was constantly surrounded by people. Mm-hmm. I had to learn how to hang out with myself.
No, it's, I mean, it is like philosophical, but at the same time, like I think it kind of stems from like loving yourself. Like you need to learn to spend time with yourself.
Yeah.
If you can't, then like, you know, why would people spend time with you? Exactly. You know what I mean?
You can surround yourself around people 24/7, but things like this where you're forced into isolation.
Yes.
You have no one to spend time with except yourself. So it was definitely something that was learned. It didn't automatically come, by no means was it easy, but it was definitely a process where I whenever I'm driving down the road, I can just blast music and have fun singing by myself. And I know that I could probably not have done that a few months ago.
It's progress.
Yeah, exactly. It's progress in a weird way, but I like it.
Totally. Well, my last question for you here, something that I like to ask all the artists that I get to talk to, is so for the person that is going to discover you from this and for the person that is going to listen to your music for the first time, what is a message that you would like to pass off to them?
My message I would like to pass on, not just about me, but like my music and my artistry, is surprising fact, Vanalika means sunflower. So I always like to say I want to brighten the world one sunflower at a time, however cheesy that sounds. And I think my main message with that is music should be used, even if it talks about darker topics, it just still bring a little bit of a smile to people's face. So if my music in any way can do that, or can make you feel a little bit brighter on a dark day, or even on a regular day, it just makes you smile a little bit bigger, that's all I can ask for. And there's nothing more I could say that would be more rewarding than that.
That's beautiful. That's a fantastic message. And it seems pretty in reach as well. So
I would hope so. But hey, if you hate my music, or if it brings a little bit of a frown, let me know and we can have a little bit of a discussion about that.
Yeah, just know that they're wrong.
I'm open to having a conversation for sure.
They're wrong. They're wrong. Don't worry about it. All right. For everyone else out there, by the time this comes out, Lonely will have been out. So please listen. It is a fantastic single, and please listen to the rest of her music, because it is truly vibrant and that like 70s summery, just vintage perfection. I cannot thank you enough for taking the time out of your day today to speak. Thank you so much for the super fun, in-depth answers. And I cannot wait to hear more.
No, of course. And thank you for giving me a little bit of an outlet to say how crazy I am just on camera.
Sometimes you need to tell a stranger you're crazy.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. Thank you so, so much again. Have a great rest of your night, and we will talk soon.
Yes, thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.